Ahora le cedo la palabra a Véronique de Keyser.
Let me now give the floor to Véronique de Keyser to try and sum up what's been said.
Vaste programa.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thanks very much.
Ceux qui restent ici.
And I'd like to thank the speakers who are still with us. And I don't think it's going to be that hard to conclude, actually, because I think everything's been said and in a very clear message, so I'm sure the message has got through. I do want to go back to a distinction that Mr. Curler made, because it's the first time that there's such a crisis with regard to migrants in Europe. I mean, there was reference to the war in Yugoslavia made. The people of Kosovo came to Europe, and there was compassion shown then, citizens' initiatives, extraordinary mobilization. I think today, though, there's as much fear as compassion being shown. And I think there, Elmar Brok really summed up the specific nature of the current migrant crisis. I mean, first of all, you have the lack of a European immigration policy, and that causes problems at every stage. I mean, the criteria for claiming asylum are very different. I mean, we all know that when it comes to asylum seekers, Europe does have something to say when it comes to the conditions, etc. But it's up to member states to decide how many asylum seekers they'll take. I mean, there are certain emergency procedures. The texts say that solidarity should be shown when it comes to distributing migrants, etc. But the fact is that we're seeing a crisis of solidarity when it comes to migrant situation. So that's the first thing I wanted to say. The second thing is that we're still seeing the after effects of the terrible economic crisis that we suffered. We've also had austerity policies that have caused problems for our citizens. And people say, well, you know, we've made sacrifices all across the board, and there are people who are just turning up and being given everything. So that's what members of the general public are saying. And then third issue is terrorism, and the fact that people struggle to distinguish between Muslims, Islamists, etc. I mean, people are openly saying they're Islamophobic at the moment, and they're saying, well, Islam is a dangerous religion. And then it's not that far to say that all the Muslims that come to Europe are terrorists, quite apart from the fact that some terrorists do come back to Europe or to Europe. So that also causes a problem, and that means that in spite of the fact that this wave of refugees was entirely predictable, we still haven't done anything. I mean, I went to Lebanon, Jordan, Syria, etc. a few years ago. There were already masses of refugees in Lebanon at the time. There were 3 million children who hadn't been to school for 3 years. There was there were all sorts of things going on in Syria. Now you've got, of course, Lebanon that is falling apart under the pressure of the weight of numbers of Syrians, of refugees from Syria, excuse me. I mean, the borders are pretty fluid between Lebanon and Syria. So people, you know, refugees were fleeing to Lebanon and then were going back to Syria, back home to see how things were going and then going back. And this was back in 2013. So nothing has been done. Everyone basically since then has been crossing their fingers and hoping that nothing would happen back in Europe. And basically we're setting all our hopes on humanitarian assistance. Basically we've been sticking our heads in the sand, and then suddenly we've got this crisis and everyone stands up and says, goodness me, what's this all about? How did this happen? I hope we're going to find proper solutions for what's going on. I mean, all these initiatives that are being carried out by members of the general public, I think, are helping. But until we have solidarity, then we're basically making our bed and we're going to have to lie in it. I mean, walls are completely useless. Elmar said it. I mean, people go round walls. People take different, more dangerous routes. Walls are useless. And it also produces an image of Europe that undermines our values. We underestimate the potential that migration could have for us. And Mrs. Thompson, you've just mentioned that their migrants do have significant potential for us. So I think we're making mistakes here. We still haven't done enough to deal with the crisis that we're facing. I mean, I have faith in the EU machinery, and I hope that we will be able to do something, because all too often member states are basically just looking at their own national and short-term electoral interests. I mean, I hope that we're going to realise that it's the future of Europe that's at stake now, which makes this really a particularly dangerous crisis. Now, let me also just say a little bit about the rest of the world, because it's not only about Europe. I mean, Mrs. McGuinness and Mrs. Thompson said that there are migrants elsewhere in the world as well. There are migration and development policies that need to be implemented to ensure that people stay where they want to live and can move when they want to move. But first and foremost, that people can stay where they want to live. And I should say that I'm a little bit less pessimistic when it comes to that issue, because there are many, many instruments that have been set up now to try and deal with the issues of migration and development in a global manner. The European Union has a remit to act in developing countries, because there are agreements in place, partnership agreements with sub-Saharan Africa. There are also agreements when it comes to neighbourhood policy. And there's a whole series of instruments ranging from political dialogue to targeted programmes to help people in developing countries. And so I think that when it comes to southern development, I am less pessimistic, but there are still things to be done. The issue of readmission is linked to development now. We say, we'll give you your development aid, but as long as it's linked to agreements on readmission. I mean, I don't have enough time to discuss it in full here, but we came to readmission agreements with Gaddafi back in the day. But we were fully aware at the time that that meant almost certain death for some people who were sent back. Fortunately, the Libyan revolution intervened prior to these agreements actually being implemented. But I don't want the same mistake to be repeated with other countries who I won't mention here. I do want to see these agreements be underpinned by the principles of human rights. These really need to be key in these readmission and development agreements. Well, that's all I've got time for here. Alas, the interpreters have to leave at 5 o'clock. But I think there's an awful lot that still needs to be said, and we'll have a great deal to discuss over dinner, if nothing else, on readmission agreements. Thank you very much.